So welcome everybody. This is Peter Bauer from Centogene and I'm glad to welcome you to our webinar talking about Gaucher disease and going beyond the paradigms of the established knowledge, adding new insights for this rare disease, rare treatable disease. So I think we are on time and I would like to guide you through this webinar. I'm the chief scientific officer of Centogene, human geneticist by background, and very, very interested to link genetic and metabolic insights in providing a better basis for therapeutic decisions in patients with rare diseases. And I believe Gaucher disease is one of the excellent examples where this happened, and many patients benefited from these insights. You can see in this intro slide where we're located, on the bottom in this new building at the Warnow, which is the river flowing in the Baltic Sea in Rostock, the background of the city. From there, I would like to take you now into the topic of Gaucher disease. We have, of course, to understand a little bit about the background of the disease, some clinical features and the pathophysiology, and then most and foremost, how the disease is diagnosed and treated, and what biomarkers help us in understanding patients and as well the indication for treatment. Finally, I would like to introduce you with our app, which helps patients to monitor their biomarker levels and understand better or give feedback about their clinical symptoms. Now, Gaucher disease is the most common of the lysosomal diseases, which is a multisystemic disease of genetic origin. So we see a broad range of clinical spectrums that is usually progressing with no untreated and based on different genotypes as well, the onset of symptoms is very variable. So it's not easy to establish a diagnosis, which comes as well with one of the biggest challenges in this disease. The enzyme that is deficient is the glucocerebrosidase, which is well, we learned that pathogenic variants in this gene called GBA produce a dysfunctional enzyme, which causes the accumulation of glucocerebrosides in the mononucleotic phagocytic system, macrophages. And this is causing then follow-up symptoms because this accumulation of substrates causes inflammation and increases the size of the spleen, the liver, produces infiltration in the bone marrow with defective blood production and especially production of platelets. And in a subset of the phenotype, we have severe, sometimes very severe central nervous system symptoms. So as you can see on the right side, the disease can be very, very mild and very, very disease severe. So it's really important to understand the basis of this disease for any prognosis in patients. The disease is autosomal recessive, which means we have usually a B allelic inactivation of the enzyme activity, which produces then a very low enzymatic residual capacity. And then over the years or months, accumulation of substrates and the symptoms I already mentioned. The prevalence, the incidence is 1 in 40,000 or 60,000 in the general population. And the prevalence varies between different ethnic backgrounds. So in general, in Caucasians, we have between 1 to 60,000 in Australia, 1 to 100,000 in the Netherlands, and already described for decades, a very high prevalence in Ashkenazi Jews, where one in 855 is affected by Gaucher disease, which means more than every 20th is a carrier of a mutant allele. And so the mating of two carriers has a 25% risk of producing progeny with Gaucher disease. The clinical spectrum is broad, and we have in principle three different types of disease. One is the mild type 1, where we have nonetheless mild to significant visceral symptoms, which involves the bone marrow and clinically the bone, which is impaired. And we have deposits in the liver and the spleen, hepatosplenomegalia, and as a consequence of the bone marrow involvement, anemia and thrombocytopenia. Type 1 does not show, by definition, involvement of the central nervous system. While type 2 and 3 are primary neurological diseases, type 2, the very severe early onset disease, while type 3 is the more prolonged neurological disease form. There's a rare type where symptoms are mainly cardiovascular, with calcification of the aortic or the mitral valve, and some neurological involvement. And there's as well a very rare lethal perinatal form, where skin abnormality, ichthyosis, and fetal hydrops are seen. The affected organs, as already mentioned, are mainly the brain, the lungs, the liver, and the spleen. And in this respect, it's good to know that in Central Europe, roughly 90%, 95% of the patients are Gaucher disease type 1 patients without neurodegeneration. And for these patients, genotyping has a prognostic value, because we know and learned that one of the most common alleles at codon 409, aspirin to serine, is protecting carriers from developing neurological symptoms. So this is one of the predictions we can take. However, carrier risk for Parkinson's, which will not be addressed today in this talk, is not eliminated in these GBA carriers. While on the other side, while in this line, homozygosity for the aspirin gene to serine at position 409 and the arginine to histidine is 535, tend to be mild diseases. We have on the other side the prevalent other Ashkenazi variant, the leucine 483 prolan, which tend to be very severe and causes type 2 and type 3 disease with involvement of the brain. So this slide gives you an overview over the major clinical types, where you can see the prevalence once again is in the range of 60,000 to 100,000. While the more severe acute infantile neuronopathic or superacute juvenile neuronopathic are much rarer. And likewise, the age of onset is later in the type 1, where we have childhood to asymptomatic cases, while type 2 and 3 as the termination or the terminology already tells you is more severe and starts at birth or in early infancy or childhood. Lifespan is not limited in type 1, the visceral type, while as soon as there is neurodegeneration in the children, there is limited life expectancies, the more severe in type 2 with the acute form, and there the dysfunction of the central nervous system with seizures, hypertonia, and mental retardation is mainly limiting the life expectancies. If we look on the subtypes, we can as well say that an adult onset is typical for type 1, where we don't have CNS involvement, but primary bone disease with hepatosplenomegaly, cytopenia, and pulmonary disease. While on the other side, when neurological symptoms show up, usually there's no bone disease, which has to do probably as well with the fact that those children rapidly deteriorate and then, of course, have maybe not a disease course to develop these chronic symptoms of Gaucher disease. Just not to leave out the rare forms, the very rare forms, which is the perinatal lethal form with a primary CNS involvement, severe form of movement disorder, no bone disease, but this ichthyosiform skin changes and the non-immune hydrops fetalis, while, as already mentioned, the cardiovascular predominant variant is limited to only one mutant allele so far. I will give you more details later in the talk. Children have oculomotor apraxia. They have calcification of the big arteries or the valves at the heart. And since it's more protracted, they also show bone disease. Now, if we want to understand the disease, we have to look into the dysfunction of the protein, which is an enzyme. And the enzyme, the glucocerebrosidase deficiency, leads to an accumulation of cerebrosides in the lysosomes of macrophages in the tissues of the reticuloendothelial system, which means basically almost everywhere in the periphery and in the neuronopathic variant of the disease, as well in the central nervous system, where the reticuloendothelial system is represented probably by the microglial cells. So there's a chronic substrate accumulation because the enzyme is deficient and macrophages grow and grow until they die, and then the next macrophages need to get rid of the debris of these dead macrophages. And so there's a vicious cycle where the pathophysiology just leads to progressive organ damage, which is probably due to inflammation and just the accumulation of these substrates, which cause dysfunction of the organs. Gaucher cells were usually seen in the tissue because these are the macrophages that contain all these substrates, and they can infiltrate, as said, especially the bone marrow, the spleen, and the liver. So if we look in more detail into the clinical subtypes for type 1 Gaucher disease, the hallmark is that people have more or less severe pain in their organs because the liver and the spleen is large and sensitive to pain, and they can develop pretty rapidly bone crisis, which comes along with deep bone pain, usually confined to one joint or extremity, with fever and leukocytosis because it's a sterile inflammation in the bone. And you can show on x-rays that the picture looks like in osteomyelitis, which is not the case, so it's aseptic. The trabecular structure of the bones is changed. The radiologist will tell you something about an Erlenmeyer flask configuration where the epiphyses are usually spared. Nonetheless, there's a risk that the bone breaks and you can have pathologic fractures in the patients with these infiltrations of the bone marrow primarily. MRI shows involvement of the marrow and fibrosis or infarction, and the densitometry shows you osteopenia at several degrees. And this bone disease is the most debilitating feature of Gaucher disease type 1 because people lose their ambulation when this affects the humerus or other big joints with pathologic fractures. And on top, of course, it's very painful. The visceral symptoms are usually better supported by the patients, since very rarely you have diffusion problems in the spleen, which can be very acute, but usually it's just a chronic large liver and spleen with the mild to severe pancytopenia as a consequence, because blood cells are cleared more rapidly from the bloodstream. And so that's something to be looked at upon when dealing with Gaucher disease patients. Now, if you compare the primary neurologic diseases, they can have in common signs of CNS dysfunction, like swallowing difficulties, breathing difficulties, ocular motor apraxia, seizures, myoclonic epilepsies, a common feature and hard to treat. And then, as said, in type 2, the very rapid onset disease, there is rapid progression, limited psychomotor development, and early death of these children within 2 to 4 years. Those children do not respond to specific treatment. I will tell in more detail later, but that's really a type of disease we cannot really change or affect by the drugs we have at hand at the moment. In the subacute, more chronic form, type 3, the progression is usually slower, and the lifespan is expanding in the third to fourth decade. Still, the psychomotor development is impaired, and there is considerable disease burden in those children. From the clinical picture, just seeing the patients, you can diagnose the hepatosplenomegaly. You see usually big organs. You can palpate them, and children are stressed by this painful organomegaly. But of course, the neurological symptoms are more severe, and you can see a classical early onset severe infantile form with the classical mutation leucine 4A3 proline. Interestingly, I will come to that later. There's two other homozygous variants seen in the very same child. And on the right side, you can see a type 3 child as well, with enlargement of the belly and myoclonic epilepsy with a couple of variants. I have to explain you later how this could arise. Now, when we look at diagnosis and treatment, we can review a couple of typical cases with diagnostic decisions. This one is a classical one. A woman in her 40s who has a moderate bleeding after hip replacement and a severe anemia, and you also detect hepatosplenomegaly. Of course, this is a nice case where you have a consequence of the bone marrow infiltration that destroyed the femur and necessitated the hip replacement. But with the bone marrow infiltration, the patient was already anemic and was thrombocytopenic, and therefore there was bleeding after the hip replacement. And now when you see the organomegaly, how could you proceed to confirm or rule out Gaucher disease? It's pretty easy. You can ask for an enzymatic test and the GBA enzyme activity as measured in peripheral blood leukocytes. It's usually 0 to 15% of normal activity, rarely zero, because in the literature it's pretty established that a complete loss of function mutations probably do not survive the the fetal phase. And on top, you can do molecular analysis of the GBA gene. You can sequence the exons and come back with B allelic, pathogenic, or likely pathogenic variants. And in this woman with the symptoms, we have seen that she's homozygous for the one of the common Ashkenazi variants, in this case, the severe one, but she apparently had the more pretty mild phenotype. She's homozygous, so both alleles are affected. And you can see that the beta-glucuronidase activity is below the limit of quantification, which means, at least in this test, no activity measured. And this establishes the diagnosis with a known pathogenic variant and confirmation of missing enzyme activity. You can see as well that there's a biomarker mentioned, lyso-GB1, which I will discuss with you in more detail in the fourth part of this talk. So this is a very clear case. However, we sometimes have challenges because the GBA gene has a high homology with a non-expressed pseudogene, GBAP. And a simple PCR test, which is the standard for amplification sequencing material, must be designed to account for that, which means you have to exclude the pseudogene because only variants in the active copy can give rise to disease. Moreover, we've seen a couple of complex rearrangements between gene and pseudogene, which is a genetic mechanism which is called non-homologous recombination. And these complex alleles exist. And of course, we know as well that sometimes it's not coding, but it's non-coding pathogenic variants, deletions of exons or variants in the untranslated region of the gene. So you have to focus your genetic test towards all these particularities of GBA and be aware that if you test only for the most common alleles, which is the codon 409 and the codon 483, you will detect roughly 60% of the variants, but you will miss 40, especially in the non-Ashkenazi population. This is a chart that shows you in a scheme the gene GBA with 11 coding exons, which codes for the beta-glucuronidase, while the pseudogene is almost 100% identical, which means has exactly the same DNA sequence, but is not used for gene expression, which means it's silent and therefore has no function. But you will see in a minute what can happen when genetics plays around with this gene and pseudogene at the very same locus. And this is already the case study where we have sequenced a man with Gaucher disease in his 40s, typical clinical picture with cytopenia, osteopenia fractures, and hepatomegaly. And after genetic test, you have not been reported with a homozygous variant, known variant, but three alleles have been mentioned. And of course, that's a little bit surprising because you would expect to have only one rare explanation for this rare disease. Why do we find three alleles? Is it a mistake of the lab, or what is the biology there? We have seen that these recombinations between the gene and the pseudogene arise in roughly 10 to 20%, depending on the ethnicity of the Gaucher disease patients, had at least one allele with more than one mutant change in the sequence. How does this look like? For example, here we have illustrated that only the exon 1 and 2 of the gene have been linked with exons 3 to 11 of the pseudogene. And of course, this new allele is not as functional as the real transcript and comes with sometimes severe impairment of the enzyme function. It has already been shown in the 90s. These complex alleles have been detected by restriction enzymes, and therefore they are called after these enzymes, REC-NCE, so the recombination that can be measured by the NCI restriction enzyme. And there are a few others which combine two or three or sometimes even five alleles on the very same chromosome. This is an event of gene conversion and usually not of reciprocal recombination. And sometimes even a rare, more complex mechanism give rise to these alleles. What can we say about the genotype-phenotype correlations in GBA? Usually the enzyme activity you can measure in the leukocytes of the patients do not correlate with the disease type or severity. So this is not a predictor. You can have moderate reduction in severe phenotype, and you can have a severe reduction in a mild phenotype. So there are genetic and non-genetic modifiers of the disease. The severe neuronopathic variant of Gaucher disease is usually homozygous for the codon 448 or 255, and the perinasal lethal form has as well a homozygosity for known recombinant alleles. So that's kind of a rough genotype-phenotype correlation. And as already mentioned, the cardiovascular form is usually homozygous for the aspartate 448 histidine variant. But still, there is a few cases published, and not a surprise as well, a few other case reports are out there expanding the spectrum of variants that are at least contributing as well to the cardiovascular form. Now, very important question. I told you that this disease can be very mild. So if you have an asymptomatic 40-year-old who has received a diagnosis because he was identified with an index patient in the family, would you think an asymptomatic patient would need treatment? A very important question and paradigmatic. Usually you would say, well, if there's no symptoms, you don't need treatment. But be aware that the facts tell us that even an unaffected patient can already have disformation of the bone, can have liver and spleen enlargement, can have changes in the echocardiography due to the storage in the myocard, can have coagulation abnormalities and pulmonary involvement. So the clinical spectrum is kind of the end we see as a physician, and the patient might already have subtle changes that will benefit from treatment. And if you treat early, of course, you can avoid having severe complications of the disease. So the evidence is only after clinical evaluation and the determination of subclinical abnormalities. Such a decision should be taken. And in this case, if already radiographic changes are there, we would offer this patient a treatment to avoid having him non-ambulatory in 5 or 10 years. So in this case, a clear yes to start treatment in this patient. But what is the treatment? So in principle, we have four different activities after diagnosis. One is to check the manifestations, the symptoms and sign of the disease, and treat symptomatically what is possible, or causal treatment. We want to prevent primary manifestation where possible, and of course we want to prevent secondary complications, and in the end, of course, we can as well derive some information for the non-affected or genetic counseling. So what manifestation can be treated? You've seen it's it involves the lung, the liver, the spleen, the blood system, and so therefore already you see, and of course the nervous system, you need a multidisciplinary team to address all these topics. And of course, you can be supportive, for example, by blood transfusion in patients that have severe anemia. You can help them with their bone health by anti-resorptive agents, calcium, vitamin D, analgesics for bone pain, of course. And the anemia can, of course, be supported by iron supplementation and vitamins. The most and most important therapy, of course, is enzyme replacement therapy, which is something most of the symptomatic and many asymptomatic or early symptomatic patients receive. There's an alternative with substrate reduction in cases where ERT enzyme replacement therapy is not efficient. And of course, if there is severe hypersplenism, you can consider splenectomy and for those that have orthopedic dysfunction and joint collapse, you probably need to replace those joints in the patients. Now, in more detail, if you want to prevent the primary manifestation, there can be bone marrow transplantation with non-GBA deficient cells, which has been used in the neuronopathic forms. However, it does not stop the disease progression and so is not really a cure. Most importantly, enzyme replacement therapy with those drugs, recombinant enzymes mentioned, imiglucerase, tyliglucerase, or velaglucerase, is in the market and are reverting hematologic and visceral symptoms. So I have a clear benefit. Amount of ERT usually is titrated against clinical efficacy. And in those patients that are not amenable for ERT, be it that they do not respond or they have severe adverse effects, you can go for a substrate reduction therapy, which could be miglustat or eliglustat, which is an oral treatment with the main indication of mild and moderate Gaucher disease type 1, as you can see on this slide. If you want to prevent secondary complications, it's as well to avoid that they have infarction, so or the other way, that they have bleeding, so you have to monitor thrombocytopenia, and you have to counsel patients that anticoagulants are not to be used if not indicated by a physician, which includes as well non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, which can have these side effects on thrombocytes. And of course, you will monitor side effects of ERT, which can be immunogenic, allergic, or have some cross-reaction. And so monitoring of treated patients is very, very important to be aware that the anticipated beneficial effects are not countered by any secondary complications. Finally, establishment of a genetic diagnosis helps you to have surveillance and genetic counseling in the families, and you can offer enzymatic and genetic testing for all at-risk relatives, siblings usually, and help them to have an early diagnosis and early treatment to avoid any complications from disease. I think it's time to introduce a very efficient biomarker which helps to monitor these patients and define the therapeutic strategy in those patients. And the nice thing about lyso-GB1, which was developed by Centogene, is that it not only helps to diagnose patients, but it monitors the severity of the disease and thereby plays a crucial role in advancing personalized therapy of Cauchy disease patients. And to illustrate that, we have to go a step back into the 90s and the early new century, where the lyso-GB1 was not around. So chitotriosidase, the second column, was used in the 90s to see the involvement of storage cells in Gaucher disease with a pretty good sensitivity. So almost 9 out of 10, more than 9 out of 10 patients with Gaucher disease had positive tests and still acceptable specificity. So the false positive rate was kind of 14% in this marker. Nonetheless, the levels have been varied very significantly, and there is another genetic disorder, the CHIT1 deficiency, in 6% of the general population, which led to the false test results. Another CCL18 chemokine produced in macrophages was used until 2006, but as you can see, had poor sensitivity of only 76%, and as well not ideal specificity with 79%. Now you can see that glucosyl sphingosine, lyso-GB1, the metabolic product of glucosylceramide, so it's really in the heart of the pathophysiology of Gaucher disease, has an unprecedented sensitivity of 100% and specificity of 100%, which is due to the combined testing of this marker and the genetics to confirm. And you can see that the quantification of this biomarker serves as an indicator of disease burden and response to treatment, where you can show that after you have put patients on treatment, the level of the lyso-GB1 goes down gradually from usually the high hundreds into the 20s to 40s by a reduction of a significant amount of this disease burden. And this is exactly what you would like to have as a steering tool, where you can now show that the drug is not only applied, but as well doing what it should do, bringing down the disease burden in the patient. And this marker as well correlates with disease symptoms. You can see that, for example, in a patient here shown on the right, this was a neonatal or prenatal diagnosis of a child with homozygosity for N201 serine. And we could show that after birth, there was a steady increase of lyso-GB1 accumulation of this substrate. And then after 4 months, it was decided that with levels around 400, treatment should be started. Unfortunately, this child with a neuropathic variant did not respond to treatment. However, you can see on the bottom on the right that the patient diagnosed at age of 15 with Gaucher disease type 1 really had a reduction of the lyso-GB1 levels from more than 1,000 at the beginning to less than 200, and then after efficient dosage of enzyme at the end, even to less than 50 nanograms per milliliter with the N409 serine in heterozygosity with another allele. What you can see in the middle is that lyso-GB1 is highly specific for Gaucher disease, so there is no normal values in patients, and as well there is no abnormal values in controls. And we have shown that with a large number of samples. This is just the paper published. Well, meanwhile, we have more than 1,000 patients diagnosed. Now, if we look at the clinical utility of lyso-GB1, of course, it helps you to just adjust the amount of enzyme taken to replenish the lack of GBA activity by checking the levels and changing then from time to time the dosage of the enzyme replacement therapy. So if you do a quarterly measurement, or if you treat acutely even more often of lyso-GB1, you can then just correlate, as seen here, with the levels, which comes down from 200 to 48, and then goes up once again in June 18 in this chart, and then you adjust the dosage, bring it down again. And so it's an back and forth, like, of course, the disease is never stable and has some other influencing factors we are not fully aware yet. This is one side where this marker is helping you to adjust dosage, and sometimes really save significant money because you don't have to treat patients that have already good values. And to help you as well to monitor that, you can see that with the MyLSD app, which has been developed by us, you have a tool where the patient just gets this information and can feedback clinical scores and, for example, pain scores to make this feedback loop even more efficient. What does it do, the app? This collects data based on the biomarker testing, so the levels will be provided in the app by the laboratory. The patient can put in the quality of life surveys and so help to evaluate the disease status, and of course treatment is documented, so whether or not ERT is taken and in what dosage, and it's intended to be used exclusively by the patient to aid him track the treatment regimen, to monitor his own test results, and of course to see a little bit for his own educated the correlation of individual symptoms and the biomarker and the dosage of treatment. The app is openly available, and the patient data and results are accessible for the patient all the time. This can be shared with the physician and can be shared with others, stakeholders, by authorization. And of course, the monitoring over time is one of the most important assets of this app, where you can of course help to understand individual disease courses. The app is not intended for diagnostics or treatment recommendations. This of course is in the responsibility and decision of the treating physician. However, it's easy to inform this process because the patient who has downloaded the app and installed it on the smartphone then can register with consent and to get his biomarker data directly in the app. He can authorize a physician data center, and he can request for follow-up measurements of the biomarker by just ordering the filter card, which is the tool where the biomarker, the blood is put on. And during the next visit at the treating physician, this monitoring center card can then be used. Blood will be applied on the card and dried, and then the clinical information will be updated, and after measurement, the patient just receives the biomarker values within his app through a secure web, which can be shared with the physician as well. The benefits is, of course, you have an effortless communication with the laboratory and the treating physician. It helps you to monitor and getting information about the quality of life correlated with disease activity. And of course, for the physician, the treating physician of the patient, he has as well a broader data set, regular monitoring, and can use this information as well for his file. And sometimes gets alerts when a biomarker is rising that something in the treatment regimen does not seem to work out fully. Now, of course, data has to be secure, and this has been certified and is under the process of getting all the certificates necessary. All the information is encrypted in transit and addressed, so nobody can steal the data and read it directly. And of course, we have a very high policy on the security of access. So to summarize, I think I shared with you that Gaucher disease is important to know about because it's the most common lysosomal storage disease with a prevalence of 1 in 1,000 in Ashkenazi and probably 1 in 50,000 in the non-Ashkenazi populations. The carrier frequency can be as high as 1 in 18. And the diagnosis is usually established clinically with blood tests, radiographies, and of course the clinical workup from the laboratory. The diagnosis is confirmed by biomarker test and genetic testing of the GBA gene and variants within the gene, with all the caveats I mentioned around the complexity with the pseudogene. And it's important to know that enzyme replacement therapy is very, very efficient in reducing the risk for bone disease and thereby can significantly improve the quality of life and protect patients from being immobilized due to severe orthopedic complications. Lyso-Gb1, I've shown you, is a useful monitor for therapeutic efficacy and supports healthcare providers in making informed decisions how to tailor drug therapy, which can be facilitated by using new digital tools in monitoring and tracking. And by having said that, I thank you for your attention, and I'm now open to answer questions, which you can put into the Q&A tool of the webinar here. On top, I ask you to accept a questionnaire, which we will send out after this webinar, where you can give us feedback about whether we met your expectations and whether you could learn enough with this webinar and so on. Now, I think time for questions and answers, and there's already one where the question is whether the any enzyme replacement therapy in testing phase, whether there's viral or mRNA therapeutics, especially for the visceral GBA or Gaucher disease. It's a good question. I think innovation in the field needs to answer the therapeutic gaps. So for those patients with type 1 Gaucher disease, usually it's not most convenient to have enzyme replacement because you have to go to an infusion every 2 weeks. However, those with neuronopathic disease course, they even suffer a steady progression, and there more needs to be done than in the visceral type of Gaucher disease, where at least state-of-the-art therapy is there. As far as today, there is still no efficient treatment for the CNS involvement, and so neither gene therapy nor mRNA therapeutics have shown any benefit in patients and even preclinical models. There's hope that we can at least avoid to have the intravenous application in the near future, and substrate reduction therapy is already part of that. And beyond, I think probably Gaucher is not the example for gene therapy because enzyme replacement is so efficient. So the risk to establish a new therapy is much higher in a disease where you have already treatment than to do it in a disease, another rare disease, where no treatment at all is available yet. So the standard still is infusion of recombinant proteins. Maybe there will be in the future oral treatment available, just avoiding the degradation of active enzyme in the gut. I think that's a potential. And for the neuronal disease, maybe small molecules will do more than the viral therapeutics, but a lot is going on because the pressure is pretty high. Okay, there's another question once again around the recombination and the complexity of the locus. So the question is whether all GBA alleles are captured by whole exome sequencing. I think a very relevant question because if you do not really diagnose clinically and ask for a specific test, many patients might receive whole exome sequencing as a diagnostic test. And what we've seen in our hands is that you have to be very precise in the analysis of copy number changes because these complex alleles are sometimes not called in the standard pipeline, but can be seen by a more subtle analysis of the coverage of the gene and the pseudogene. And so laboratories that do account for that and do a validation on this locus might be possible to call all mutant variants. If standard pipelines are applied, I would guess that a couple of the real pathogenic variants in GBA, like in the REG-NCI, are missed in these pipelines, and therefore there is a risk for underdiagnosis of Gaucher disease in whole exome sequencing. There's another question about what is the first line therapy, and yes, it's true that it was noted that enzyme replacement therapy is established first line, but we have as well first line oral therapy in mild forms with substrate reduction therapy, and I should have mentioned it at least. I acknowledge that this is true. And this is also sometimes first line, especially when ERT does not work. I think I mentioned that when severe side effects are seen or no efficient therapy. Of course, substrate reduction therapy should be tried. Well, there's the question what whether the app monitoring one patient comes with a cost. No, it's free. So that's a service where we think we want to help patients to and physicians to monitor the patients. And of course, for us, the benefit is that we have easier data exchange and we are more secure and safe with knowing that the information really reached the patient, making him available to take actions and talk with his treating physician. Another question is whether the lyso-GB1 value varies in asymptomatic patients. Yes, it does. It does not show normal values, so they have clearly lyso-GB1 levels above the threshold of 12 nanogram per milliliter, but usually if they don't have symptoms, they don't have values above 100. But as said, it's variable, and sometimes we see in asymptomatic patients with a value of 100, and we see a severely or more severe affected one with a value of 50. So it's not directly correlating in every patient, but on average, we can say that the severe forms usually have values between in the hundreds or even above 1,000, while the mild ones are between 20 and 100. So there's a correlation, but the predictive value is not great. So we are working on additional markers to help to understand these differences. There's a question whether the app covers access to genetic counselors. It does not. The app is established in symptomatic patients, and therefore it's helping to monitor a disease that is already diagnosed and is now only monitored. Does not have to do something with establishing a genetic diagnosis. That's a step before patients sign onto the app. And then maybe the last question I can answer today is the question, what is the differential diagnosis of a 2-year-old child with hepatosplenomegaly? For us, one of the more prominent, of course, are other hereditary hepatic diseases. Which is sometimes really missed or mistaken for Gaucher disease is Niemann-Pick type C disease. It can be as well Niemann-Pick type AB, which can be mistaken for the early onset form, while the Niemann-Pick type C has some hepatosplenomegaly, but always signs of neurodegeneration, at least later in the disease course. And if glucocerebrosidase and GBA sequencing have been normal, I would recommend to test the lyso-SM509 biomarker for Niemann-Pick type A, B, and C, or go for sequencing of SMPD1 or NPC1, NPC2 genes to come up with a diagnosis in a child. If this is negative as well, I think all the others are differential diagnosis, at least the genetic ones are rare, and I would recommend to do exome sequencing then as a reflex test in a negative child. And of course, a 2-year-old needs a diagnosis, which is usually genetic. So at the end, once again, I thank you for your interest and attention. I will make the slide set available later, and this webinar is already taped, so you can review something if there are still questions. And on top, once again, I want to mention that there will be a questionnaire, and we would be grateful if you would send it back with your comments. So for today, thanks for your interest in our diagnostic services, and I'm sure we will have a follow-up webinar on some related or different topic in the near future. Thank you and goodbye.